those of you who are just joining us just now, I've already welcomed the folks who were here before, so I welcome you, and I'll thank you for the opportunity to present here at the, what is it pronounced, ICERA conference here in Bloomington, Normal. And then sometimes it's Normal without the Bloomington. I'm not sure where I am. But at any rate, I'm glad to be here. And we're going to talk about mindset. And I'm using, for some of this, I'm using the book by Dr. Carol Dweck, Mindset, an awful lot of school districts in DuPage County and even in Chicago are using this book as for a book study. I read it. There's really a lot of good stuff in here. My letter speaks to that. And I think there's a lot of information that's applicable to closing the academic achievement gap, which we're going to talk a little bit about, along with looking at some of the underlying reasons that I feel the academic achievement gap has been so persistent from a cultural perspective. Want to make one disclosure for those of you who just joined us, and that is that I am an Afro-American, and I've been an Afro-American all of my life. And I just want you to know that. I'm just proud, and I just want you to know that. How many folks are here just for this session that weren't here before, just so I... Okay, about half. Okay, that's fine. Okay. So you've read the letter. There is a... we're going to be videotaped. This session is being videotaped. So I'd like for you to be on your best behavior, perhaps. I'd also like a few of you at the end of the session, if you don't mind, to go up and just talk a little bit about what you got from the session, the good, the bad, or the ugly. I'd appreciate that. Also, I believe you have a little simple evaluation form, four questions. If you could, at the end of the session, fill that out, pass it down to the end of the table, I'd appreciate that. Okay, so embracing a mindset for academic success. Here are some impact points. One of the things that we talked about in the last session, and we will talk a little bit about, is increasing cultural competence. That is, in our schools, our teachers, administrators, counselors, increasing cultural competence so that, in two ways, one in terms of ethnicity, but also in terms of economic diversity. A lot of school systems, at least in DuPage County, probably here too, have increasing numbers of kids who are free or reduced lunch or economically disadvantaged. And they come to us with a different mindset. They come to us with different ideas about education or the lack of relevance. They come to us many times with self-esteem issues and those kinds of things. So to the extent that we can become more competent about ethnicity, be it Afro-American Latino students, or about those students who come to us from economic diversity, we hopefully can begin to establish and maintain more authentic relationships with them because we've taken time to better understand them, because our schools and our businesses are based on middle class norms and values, like time. And so, again, everyone is not acculturated to that point, but they're in our schools, and so there are no child left behind, they're our responsibility. Improving parental involvement. Promoting a school culture of inclusiveness. Abating disproportionality. And by that I simply mean, if you look at the data, which is one of the reasons we have SB 100, because Afro-Americans are disproportionately suspended and expelled from schools compared to the white, Asian, and Latino peers. And I'm certainly not thinking it's all the school's fault. I said that last time, I'll say it again. But the numbers are still disproportionate. So something we need to take a look at. We need to take a look at that and see what we can do to make that better. Impacting staff diversity. One of the things that students tell us all the time, especially Afro-American and Latino students in the book Voices we just did earlier, is that they don't see representation of themselves. And of course, you know, like anything else, if you have a culture different than yours, then there's going to be a learning curve. And to the extent that there's a learning curve, it creates a challenge in terms of establishing and maintaining authentic relationships. One of the quotes that I used earlier was Dr. Comas from Yale, who says there's no significant learning without a significant relationship. And so to the extent you can forge significant relationships with students and their families, that they perceive you as authentic because you are, then I think the learning and the disproportionality is going to go down, because there's a sense that you do care and you understand me. Embrace the growth mindset. And the handout you read, the letter, I describe the growth mindset. We're going to watch a couple of video clips here, too, that's going to help us make that point. And, of course, ultimately, we want to close the academic achievement gap. And this is Dr. Comer's. He may not be at Yale. He might have retired by now, but that was his quote. No significant learning occurs without a significant relationship. And I know, and I believe you know, you think back when you were in grade school or elementary or junior high, there was one or two teachers that really made a difference, that they really resonated with you for some reason. And for me, it was an English teacher, and he was Greek. But I made the honor roll for the first time ever, because this teacher really took an interest in me. And I felt that. And I really, really thank him even today, because that made a difference. I'm going to go over this rather quickly. The folks saw this already, so I don't want to bore them. So for folks that haven't, Illinois, 2014, was not that long ago. We have the demographics where we have 49.9% white students and 17.5% black and 24.6% Hispanic, and then you have other. And then, as I said earlier, the Hispanic is the fastest growing population in our school systems in Illinois. In terms of the academic achievement gap, what we're going to talk about in terms of mindset, kind of tie them together, the causal relationship between the two, as I see it. And reading, and I'm looking at the last line, which is the PSAE, from third to eighth grade, which is the line starting at your left, going over to eighth grade, is your ISAT. And this is 2014. And you can see that Afro-Americans, in terms of reading, I believe that's 36%. Proficient, which means it's about 64% not proficient. Not a good thing, because next year you graduate and you're not proficient in reading. Latino or Hispanic students did a little bit better, but the gap is between that red and yellow line and the white and Asian students. Now granted, nobody's at 100%, that's true, which is ideal, but that's a tremendous gap. Now the other thing I want to say about that gap has been in existence forever. Generationally, even before they measured, and No Child Left Behind that started doing, you know, the ISAT, the PSAE, Florida, FCAT in Florida, same kind of test. But even before they had the ISAT and the PSAE, Afro-American students and Latino students lacked those kind of proficiencies, although they weren't being measured. So this has been a very long-standing thing in terms of the gap. So the question is why? Because until you know the underlying reasons, what are you going to fix? What are you going to work on? And when you look at math, you see a similar gap. I think it's 36% proficient in math, which leaves quite a few that are not proficient in math, Afro-Americans and Latinos. And then you get that gap between there. And the thing is, like I said last session, these kids graduate. They walk across the stage and the next year, and they get their diploma. And everybody is, you know how we are in the audience, whoo, 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 you know, go Pookie, oh, that's my boy. But Pookie got his piece of paper, but if he is deficient in reading and math, where are we going? I mean, where are we really going? And again, this has been going on for a long, long time, so it's a problem, it's a real concern in terms of closing that academic achievement gap. And so the academic achievement gap is, this is a definition, observed and persistent disparity on a number of educational measures between the performance groups of students, especially identified by gender, race, ethnicity, and socioeconomic status. So although we do not use the ISAT anymore, and we do not use the PSA anymore, because now we have PARC. But I'll ask you a question, the new folks that just came in. If we have Afro-American Latino students graduating high school, where the data, and this is straight from the data, this is not something I made up, that data is straight from the Illinois report card. So if we have 64 or 65% of our Afro-American and Latino students not proficient in reading and math, okay, so now we have PARC, and PARC is a test that talks about college and career readiness. question is, what new information are we going to find out by using PARC when we already know going into PARC that we have 64-65% of our students not proficient in reading and math? Heck no, they're not closing career ready. I just need somebody to help me understand how PARC opens our eyes and delivers us in terms of more insight. I mean, maybe there's something I'm missing, and I'm willing to learn. So if you want to pull me up at the end of the session and say, well, Mr. Gonson, you got it wrong here, fine, because I just don't quite understand that. Does anybody want to comment on that? Yes. Well, are you talking about on the graph?
Yes.
Well, that last test was a different test.
Okay.
Yeah, 1 through 8 was ISAT. Then the last one all the way over, that was the PSAE. Totally different test.
So is that why there was such a big decline because of the testing change?
Yes. That's correct. Good observation. Somebody's wide awake up in here. Are y'all sleepy? Are y'all sleepy? Did y'all party last night? You don't have to tell me. Oh, okay. Well, I'm going to stop right there. All right. So socioeconomic status is ED, economically disadvantaged. And so once again, that mindset that if you are from two generations of poverty coming to a middle-class, normed and valued school, there's going to be some differences and some nuances that unless you understand those from a cultural competence standpoint as far as economic diversity, then it's going to be a little bit more challenging to try to understand this kid. And this kid may use profanity when he gets frustrated because he doesn't have a vocabulary like you and I might have to better express how we feel and how much stress we're under, but then we send him to the principal's office. I'm not saying that we should accept that behavior, but we should mediate so the kid knows better choices of words to use so when he gets a job, he don't get fired because he gets frustrated and cuts the boss out because he don't have the words. And many of you don't have the words, I'm sure when you leave here, somebody cuts in front of you and cuts you off, you have to put your brakes on. You're not gonna say, my word, that gentleman traversed in my path of trajectory. This is unbelievable. That phenomenon has to stop. No, you're gonna say, you know, and gesture, you know. So when you're angry and upset, you don't come out with all that slick vocabulary either. So again, if you're low economic status, there's a tendency to not have the vocabulary. Okay, to use many times to express those feelings. Just like you do when somebody cuts you off, you forget your vocabulary too. And you have it. Or do you? My last group, I did a little something. I'm going to do it right now. Somebody tell me what nefarious prevaricator means. Anybody? Nefarious prevaricator. Not from the last group. You're disqualified. Don't even try it. And you're not winning no books because I can't give away mindset. I didn't write it. Nefarious prevaricator. Inflagration. Thank you. Who said that? Give that lady a hand, please. Woohoo! All right. You are AP classes, right? You took AP? Okay, just kidding. I know you're all bright. I know you are. Okay, this is a graph, and what it shows on the top is the district enrollment for Chicago. And what you will find is 41% of the students in Chicago, 41.3, are Afro-American. However, out-of-school suspensions, 69.3. It's disproportionate. And so that's SB 100 basically came out, and I think, how many of y'all know about SB 100? Okay, that's a new law that's signing that says to schools, find another way to deal with the inappropriate behavior in class as opposed to out-of-school suspensions and expulsions. Find another way. Let that be the last absolute resort. That's the new law. And so schools are now scrambling. I talked to a dean the other day and he said what he's teaching, what he's doing to help is, what I said earlier, is helping deal with relationships, helping staff better understand their kids, better understand the cultural nuances, so that those relationships hopefully will get more kids to buy in and feel included and those kind of things and cut down on the acting out behaviors that get them suspended or expelled. But that's in Chicago. So you see, African-Americans represent a way more students compared to their population. Just something to think about. Now, the book Mindset, you all have that. I mean, you have the handout. And so, again, in the handout, I just wanted to make clear, at least in my position in reading the book, how many folks have read the book Mindset? Oh, okay. Well, I'm going to give you a chance right now to go down to Borders. No, I know Borders is closed. Barnes and Nobles, I'm going to give 15 minutes, I'm going to get you a copy and come back. Can you do that? Yeah, right. It's a very good book. As you saw, it's not the answer to everything. It's not a silver bullet. But a lot of school districts that I work with, in Chicago as well, are using this book for book studies. There's a lot of good information in it, not just about schools, for instance, about even parenting. It talks about not praising kids like I used to do with my nephew who comes, my grandson, I'm sorry, who comes from first grade talking about he just learned a new word, Grandpa. I said, what is it? Onomatopoeia. In first grade, onomatopoeia, really? And he knew what it meant. Okay, so, you know, oh, Jimmy, you're so smart. And the book talks about that's really not what you should focus on, because the minute he doesn't know a word, okay, then is he not smart? Because you raise that level of expectation. Praise effort. You know, praise, well, you got a 90. With a little more effort, you could have got that 100. Not, because if you deal with smart absolutes, then, of course, you could set the kid up for failures, low self-esteem. Good stuff. So that's the overarching concept that we're going to talk about today in terms of the academic achievement gap and the mindset. Okay, this is a little thing I put together, and I just want to go through it. On the fixed mindset, you know, you have a kid in class, he's saying, what if I'm wrong? So there's a fear of taking a risk, because if you say the wrong answer, it's embarrassing. So he won't answer, he won't participate. What if it's ugly? Again, you know, overthinking. Not feeling secure. What if they don't like me? Fixed mindset. What if I mess up? These are all self-imposed negative consequences. I can't be the only Latino or Afro-American in my class. So if you're in an AP class, you at least asked or encouraged, you may not want to do it because you're concerned about being the only one. I love this one. We're not a math family. What is a math family? But you'll hear parents say, well, my son, we're just not a math family, so, you know, geometry is not his thing, or algebra is not my thing, it's my mother's thing. There is no such thing as a math family, except that's a mindset. And the growth mindset says that you can't improve, you can't rise above your circumstances because you're not a math family. So it kind of encumbers you. But many of us, when we have our kids that don't do well in school, or the disciplinary problems, or in some cases because of stereotypes, we have low expectations of them, and they have low expectations of themselves. So, you know, parents, I know parents that send their kids to school because they're struggling and they're working, and they don't care if the kid gets a D or a C, at least they pass. Because I cannot take off work and come in here and get Johnny back in school if he messes up and misbehaves. So as long as he goes to school, don't get in trouble. If he gets a D or a C, hallelujah. That mindset. And so there is no discussion about GPA, or GPA 3.0, 3.5, 4.0. There's no discussion about that, or going to AP classes, or anything else, because of the mindset. So the mountain of fear, and apprehension, and anxiety. On the other hand, growth mindset, that we have the opportunity to go beyond where we are. We believe we can. Obama said, yes, we can, or yes, I can. And he did. And he did something that I never thought, none of us thought we would see in our lifetime. But his mantra was, yes, we can. Not, well, you know, if I run for president, I'm probably wasting my time, you know, this is America. No, that wasn't the mindset he operated from. So nothing beats a failure but a try. Go for it. And if you get knocked down, how many times do you get up? Boy, that didn't seem very convincing. Let me try that again. And if you get knocked down, how many times should you get up? Many times as it takes. You still sound a little lethargic. I'm gonna try this one more time. This one raised the energy level. Did y'all have a heavy breakfast? If you get knocked down, how many times should you get up?
Always.
Thank you. Cool Jets, another adventure. AP Calc. I'm going in there and I'm gonna rock that doggone class. If it is to be, it's up to me. I'm not externalizing blame. I'm not over-dependent on someone else. If it is to be, it's up to me. And so that growth mindset, as you can see, it really motivates and allows you and perpetuates risk-taking and the belief that you can. And if you don't, like you said, you get up always, somebody said. Okay. But the mindset, as a man thinketh, right? As a woman thinketh, so is he, so is she. So as you think, your mindset guides you. We're going to see a couple little movie slides, clips, I should say, to make the point. Oh, here's one now. So how many people have seen Dangerous Minds? Okay. So I'm going to play, I love to play the whole thing, but I can't get away like our keynote did. I can't get away with that cussing. Because see, if I play the whole thing, I probably won't have a job when I get back there. But see, I know that. So don't worry about it. I'm not going to play that part. But the part I am going to play, I want you to check out, because I want you to check out the mindset. Now, let's see. Of this grandmother. Remember the grandmother? And I want you to pay attention to what she's saying.
Pardon? My boys don't go to your school no more, and that's going to be it.
You took them out of school?
You damn right I did. I saw what they were bringing home. Poetry and shit. A waste of time. They got more important things to worry about. Don't you think they're finishing high school? We got to go to their future. That's not in their future. I ain't raising no doctors and lawyers.
Why don't you just get on out of here? Go find yourself some other poor boys to save.
Okay, so what mindset do you think she's operating from?
Fixed.
Fixed mindset, correct. So she ain't raising no doctors and lawyers. So therefore, the likelihood of her grandsons becoming doctors and lawyers is pretty nil, because her mindset will not allow her to even possibly conceive of that reality. Another part of that mindset is this. Because of her mindset, the other thing she may be doing, and parents will do this, is call herself, because she means well, I'm sure, protecting her boys from disappointment. How dare you even dream about something that I know is not in your future, like she said. But let me give you the converse story of that to think about, mindset. Dr. Ben Carson, how many people know of him? Okay. I met Dr. Ben Carson on a number of occasions when I worked in Baltimore City as the clinical contract consultant for the schools in Baltimore City, because he worked at Johns Hopkins. So he'd come over and talk with the kids. And I would talk with him, but I didn't know he was all that like he is now. Of course, he's not there no more, but he dropped out. But here's the deal. Carson was a thug, seriously. He was a thug. He had a very poor education outcomes at the time. He had anger issues. His mother was functionally illiterate. She worked as a domestic worker, and she had mental health issues, DSM-3 at the time. And he was, at that time, if we knew him, we would say he's a prime candidate for juvie, you know, juvenile detention hall, you know, getting sent up, because that's where he was headed. But his mother's mindset for him and his brother was that there were going to be somebody. And she put her foot down, and of course it didn't happen overnight. But as a result of her putting her foot down and making sure that he went to school and did well in courses, no homework, I mean, no TV, that kind of thing, eventually he began to have some successes in school. And then he went on to become a neurosurgeon. And then he went on to become the chief of pediatric neurosurgery at Johns Hopkins. And now he has had aspirations to be the president of the United States. Where this mother ain't raising no doctors and lawyers, that mother was. But it was all about her mindset. So let me ask you this. How many of you either have children or know someone in your family who has children, like your nieces and nephews? And how many of y'all have some young kids that you know of? Okay. Now, honestly, do you think, and don't tell me what you know is the right answer because it sounds good, do you think they could be neurosurgeons or or something like that? I mean, could they be neurosurgeons? Okay, so then the possibility is there. Okay, because a lot of parents, when I do that, of course, their parents won't raise their hand because they have no concept. They say, well, you know, he's a good kid. I think he'll do well, but he can't be no astrophysicist. And so I ask you this. If you were born a Kennedy and your name was Jack, when you were born, you were going to law school. You didn't even know it, but you were going to law school because it was family tradition, it was legacy. You might not be president, but you're going to law school. So all of them went to law school. A couple of them had a little trouble passing the bar, as you might recall, but they went to law school. And I'm telling you, the Kennedys are no smarter from a cognitive ability standpoint than the average kid in your schools right now, as far as, you know, the brain functioning. You know, I mean, granted, if they have some cognitive situations going on or some kind of deficiencies, fine, that's different. But I'm saying all things being equal, they could also be lawyers and neurophysicists and doctors or whoever they want to be. But it's just the mindset that they're born into, like these two boys, that contributes to their reality even before they go through school. Because they all could be. Because they really had the same endowment as the Kennedys. But it's already known that if you're a Kennedy, you're going to law school. Isn't that interesting? Because that mindset goes into fruition when you're born. So I'm going to talk about six commonly held beliefs. Some of you've heard of, maybe you haven't heard of, maybe you believe it, maybe you don't. But I'm going back to these beliefs in terms of the academic achievement gap. So I'm just going to discuss briefly just six of them. One is, the reason the academic achievement gap is the way it is because of the deficient innate ability. In other words, there are some people who believe that Afro-American Latinos are just genetically predispositioned not to have the genetic characteristics for intelligence as compared to, say, white and Asian students. So therefore, there's no way that they can be as smart as them because it's not possible from a genetic standpoint. And there are books written to make that point. One of those books is called Bell Curve. How many people are familiar with the Bell Curve? Came out about 10 years ago, yeah. Another one is Tony Brown's Journal. It was a talk show and you had Dr. Shockley and Dr. Cress Welsing. She is a professor at Howard University. And they were debating the impact of genetics on intellectual acuity. And, you know, he's trying to make the same point. So for those people who gravitate towards that belief, then of course that explains it. And that's that. Tracking. Tracking is the phenomenon, if you want to call it, or the practice, maybe it's not a phenomenon, whereby kids go to school and around third grade, they end up on a lower track than other kids. And by that, I mean, when I was in high school in New York, I was the only, and it was at least, not a, a small high school, maybe about 800 kids in the high school, and about 150 of them were black, but it seemed like all of them were black. It was a crazy place in those times, you know, but there's just, you know, who were loud and all that kind of stuff. So, but what it is, I was in class, geometry, and I was in trig, I was in biology, I was in American Lit. I was the only Afro-American male in all of my classes. Now, my buddies were at school. I didn't think about it then. I didn't. I mean, I saw them after school. We played basketball, played varsity football. We lived in the projects, you know, all that. But I didn't think about it until I graduated and they started calling me Dr. Ralph and for Dr. Ralph Bunch. And later on in life, I realized that they saw me as being in the other track, the college-bound track. And then at the end of high school, when I was in my senior year, I took a course I had done on my elective, so I took bookkeeping as an extra elective because I thought that might be helpful to me down the road. And I walk in class, never forget, and there's all my buddies, all my homies. Hey, man, what's up? Hey, yo. And they're in bookkeeping because they were on a different track. No wonder they weren't in none of my classes. So when we graduated, we both got diplomas, but I had a diploma that prepared me for college, and they didn't, they had a general diploma, but I didn't know that. So tracking. So if you're on that lower track, of course you're not going to be as smart as other kids, so therefore you're not going to do as well in these tests. So that's another belief. And I think we still do have some tracking. Cultural mismatch, that is the home and school are not on the same page. Just like you saw in the in the video there on Dangerous Minds, cultural mismatch. And so therefore those kids that come from homes that where they don't believe they're raising doctors and lawyers, of course they're not going to do as well on those tests, so there's going to be that gap. That's another belief. Acting white. How many people are familiar with that connotation when you talk about Afro-Americans, Latinos, acting white? You know, speaking standard English, taking AP classes, acting white, talking white. Well, that's why I told you I was Afro-American from the jump, because I knew if I didn't, some of you are going to say, oh, he's talking white. He must be white. No, I'm not. But that's what happens. And what that does a lot of times for our kids, and you may not realize this, is they will dumb down because they want to belong. They will code switch on you, because one minute they're handing in homework. But they, if handing in homework and I see my buddy coming around the corner, I might snatch it back and say, I ain't doing none of this stupid homework for you, teacher. And you wonder, what, have you lost your mind? No, I had to cover myself because my buddy just walked by. I don't want them to see me invested in education because then they'll think I'm sucking up. I mean, that's weird, but that happens. I'm not sure if you're familiar with it. So that's a problem because we still do that to each other. Parents at fault. You know, they don't come to school meetings. They don't answer your request for meetings if you see a kid failing or a kid that's getting in trouble. So they don't care. And so therefore, the kids don't do well on tests, and that's why you have the gap. Parents aren't involved. Fear of stereotype confirmation. Well, that is this. And we're going to see this in another slide I'm going to show you in a little bit. So let's say I am a promising student and you convince me to go to the National Spelling Bee. I don't mind going to the National Spelling Bee, but all my friends say, man, you crazy. But you ain't going. So if I go and I don't win, then I come back home, man, you had no business going to that Spelling Bee in the first place. You know, who do you think you were? Or you thought you trying to act white? You trying to be up there with the white kids? You ain't going to do nothing in no Spelling Bee. It's no wonder you're back here. Now, maybe next year you'll leave it alone, that kind of thing. So I fear stereotype confirmation because I don't want to prove them right. By failing, I prove them right. The stereotype was that I should not be in AP classes. That's why I'm African-American. The stereotype could be I should not be going to a national spelling bee. I don't even belong in the spelling bee. And I tell a lot of black students, you know, basketball, you know, everybody wants to be an NBA star. But I tell a lot of black students, join the debate club. Learn how to argue for and against the same thing. Learn vocabulary that's going to help empower you for a job interview or for a career. And I don't know how many schools still have debate club, but there was a movie, what's the guy's name? Who? The Great Debaters. Yeah, thank you, bro. You cool. The Great Debaters. And that's a good movie, you know, to show Afro-Americans, because they ain't all about shooting hoops. But if you can talk and think, critical thinking is a big deal. Critical thinking is a big deal. That's going to get you somewhere. Okay, forces that threaten students' academic achievement. Let me move forward. And I'm primarily talking about Afro-Americans here. And this is my thinking. You may not agree with it, but we're trying. And in fact, let me ask the question before I can go any further. Somebody tell me why we have this long-standing, persistent, stubborn, if you will, academic achievement gap between the Afro-American students, as you saw in the graphs, and their white and Asian peers. Why do we have this academic achievement gap? Somebody tell me what you think.
I think it's because institutionalized racism that's been around since before the United States was even created.
Okay. I agree with a piece of that. And thanks for speaking out. That's courageous. I appreciate that. Institutionalized racism. Now, my point on that is this, and I said this last session. Yes, I do believe that we have some vestiges of racism and bigotry in this country, but nowhere near what it was 40, 50 years ago. To the point that there's no way that I can accept that that's the reason, primary reason, why we have the academic achievement gap, not in 2015. But I'm not saying that to say there's none, because that would be foolish. But I do want to recognize how much we've grown as a country. I remember a true story. I lived in near Elgin. I don't know how many people know where Elgin is. and there's a ritzy part of Elgin called South Elgin, and it was New Year's, and it was foggy a couple years ago, and my cousin was having a party. And so I drove out there, and I pulled up, and the garage door was open, so I got out. I walked in the garage, and all the shoes was in the garage, so I thought it was kind of odd, but I mean, not odd, but odd for her, but I took my shoes off, and I walked in the garage, the door, and I walked up some steps to another landing in the kitchen. I heard people laughing, and true story, but it was kind of dim in there, and I saw a flickering, so they had candles. So as I walked up, I got to the top in the house, I turned and looked, and there was about seven people sitting around a table with candles, and they were all white, and I didn't know them. I was in the wrong house. True story. Because the houses look alike, you know, you get there and it was foggy. I'm in the wrong house, so I'm saying, you know what I'm saying. And so I looked at them and they looked at me, and the first thing I'm looking for is somebody to grab the cell phone to call a popo. The second thing I'm looking for is somebody to grab the purse or whatever, because I'm in these people's house, all up in there. And you know what they did? They looked at me, I looked at them, and I'm like, oh boy. And they said, hey, I'm in the wrong house. I was looking for my cousin. Oh, well, it's okay, since you're here, why don't you join us for dinner? We've come a long ways. A long way. True story. I mean, I like those people. But I mean, and that's a true story, and I wasn't comfortable. I didn't stay for dinner. I wasn't Sidney Poitier, but and back in the day, it wouldn't have happened like that. Okay? I might not even be here. So, having said that, I talk about the Afro-American cultural DNA. Like, you know, if you have DNA in your family, you have blue eyes, your great-great-grandmother had blue eyes, your great-great-great-grandmother had blue eyes, so you have blue eyes, or a certain texture here. That's physical DNA, physiological. But I'm talking about cultural DNA in the same metaphor. So what I'm saying is the culmination of Afro-Americans' generational life experiences through historical social periods in the United States, changing ideologies, beliefs, languages, customs, traditions, philosophies, and other cultural traits that continue to impact today's and future generations of Afro-Americans in both positive and adverse ways. That's my definition for cultural DNA. Now, having said that, again, we're talking about the split. We're talking about the cultural split, and we're talking about what I'm looking at, and it goes back in part to what the gentleman said in the back in terms of the achievement gap. So here is a mental model, and here's why I say it's a cultural split. I'm going to give you a couple of examples. Obama impact is up there. Afro, dashikis. There was a time that, and some of you might not know some of this, but there was a time that we wore dashikis. You know, how many people know what a dashiki is? Okay, a dashiki is an African shirt, just kind of like a poncho, and it's got all kind of colors in it. And so we, as Afro-Americans, we wore those because we were trying to identify. You know, we came here from slavery, we know that. That was the dark age in the United States. But as we came through slavery, but even in slavery, you had slaves in the house, you had slaves in the field. And of course, there was some jealousy. Malcolm X talks about that. Because if you're in the house and it's raining and everything, at least you're warm. You're a slave, but at least you're warm, you get better food. If you're in the field, it's pretty rough. So over time, generations, you know, there's this resentment between those two because of the difference in terms of what was going on at that time. But then when you come forward and you look at civil rights, again, I'm showing you the cultural split now. You had civil rights where you had Jesse Jackson, you had Martin Luther King, you had Ralph Abernathy, remember those folks? You had CORE, Congress of Racial Equality, and they were black and white together, we shall overcome, and that was good. But at the same time, right in there you had another organization or ideology called the Black Power Movement, militant. You know, you had H. Rapp Brown, you had Eldridge Cleaver, you had Huey P. Newton, you had Angela Davis. Remember those? You had the Black Panthers. So if you're Afro-American, because our names changed so many times, we weren't Afro-Americans then, but to make the point, then which side were you on? Which ideology did you embrace? Well, if I was with my buddies, my homies in the barbershop, you know, I'm with, you know, hey man, you know, power to the people, because that's the generational thing. But if I'm with my mom and dad and they're in church, it's like Martin Luther King, Mom, we shall overcome. So I was split. But I played both sides, called marginality. But again, as Afro-Americans, you had basically those two choices in terms of what you embraced. So if you embraced civil rights, then of course you wanted to go to schools where you had black and white and the cultural enrichment. But if you were from the power movement, you wanted your own school. Yes?
if they make a change over to African American? Let's ask some questions.
Okay, I don't know when in terms of a timeline, but I think it changed over, I'm going to guess, and maybe somebody else might know, I'm going to guess maybe around the 80s, because we weren't Negroes, and of course, we transcended from black, you know, I'm black and I'm proud, that was James Brown, and so Afro-American, to me, was the last label, because it talks about, since we weren't born in America, but we came from slavery, but we're in America, the African ancestry part, and then the American now part came together as African Americans. That's like the tie-in.
Yeah, because I have some people that question that label, the younger children.
Well, what do they call themselves?
Black.
Oh, that's, yeah.
And they say they've been American all their lives.
Yeah.
They did not come from Africa.
Right. No, they didn't. But cultural DNA, see, DNA is, it's in your system.
But I think they're mixing ethnicity with, because on your passport, it says United States of America.
Right.
It does not say African.
Right. I think that's a contemporary ethnicity category, but as far as I know, and I'm black too, they're interchangeable as far as I'm concerned. I mean, if you're black, fine. If you're African, I don't see any issue with either one of them. I don't, in terms of identifying who I am, because when I say it, you know what I'm talking about.
Well, I think it's the label.
It could be. It could be.
But we do have African friends that truly came from Africa.
Yeah.
And on their passport, it does have African American.
Right. Wow. That's a good point, and I wish I could give you a better answer.
And we also have some white friends that migrated. I mean, they live here now.
Yes.
They came from South Africa.
Correct.
So they're African American.
That's true. I mean, you made a good point. And again, it, in terms of the contemporary aspect of it, we're all human beings. We belong to the human race. But we have labels, as you know. We have labels for various reasons. So you make a good point. Well, we got to go from apartheid. I mean, we're getting off in the. But when apartheid went away, of course, then you had a clearer picture of the diversity. But apartheid was basically you either in or you're out. And so that was pretty, but that went away, that system went away, just like I'm saying here in America, you know, Jim Crow and de facto segregation, a lot of those practices have gone away. And we've evolved, you know, to hopefully to a higher civility in terms of the human race.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
I do.
Because, but here it's because the color of the skin that we call African American. Because Africa is an identified as, you know, middle class, people that have the money and.
Right. In many countries. It's like a caste system.
Yeah.
Yeah, in many countries. Even in America, it's about SES, really, nowadays. It's about socioeconomic standing, you know. So my point here was to show you the split so that. When you have an Afro-American in your classroom, you might have two Afro-Americans. You're going to see this in a video in just a minute. I'm going to show a video from Akilah and the Bee. But you can have two people that look like they're the same, but they're not necessarily the same from the standpoint of what they espouse and what they embrace. But from an ethnicity standpoint, you say, yes, they're Afro-American. And the point I'm going to with that is you ask about the academic achievement gap. Well, if talking standard English is acting white, and you have other folks who frown on that and who put our kids down for being in AP classes, then it's almost not hip to be smart. And there's some authors, I can't think of his name, who wrote a book, To Be Popular or Smart. It's a dilemma in our culture that that I think contributes to the achievement gap, because if education is not relevant, because you're acting white. Even in, there's another book called The Invisible Man by Ralph Ellison. And in that book, that book's about 30 or 40 years old. But you had an Afro-American who subscribed to getting an education so he could have a better quality of life for his family. So when he goes to college, which meant he was acting white, and he wants to move out of that neighborhood, we got drugs and violence and poor housing and those kind of things, to a neighborhood that had better schools so his family could fare better, and that would be a good thing. But here's the problem. He goes to that neighborhood And he can live there, but he can't join the country club because folks don't want the African-American in the community, but they'll accept him in the housing because he got federal laws. So he's not accepted there. But then he goes back to the hood to get a haircut. Hey, bro. Hey, what you doing here? You ain't one of us, man. Go on back where you came from. So he can't go either place. That's the invisible man. Okay? And that's a dilemma that, you know, some of you may not be aware of. That's in the cultural DNA of African-Americans. Good hair and bad hair. You know, Imus in the morning got in trouble for calling the team, the female basketball players. He said they were nappy-headed, you know what? Well, only one of them had Afro hair, but why does kinky hair have to be bad hair? But that's what we do to ourselves. And so the other thing that goes on in our cultural DNA, in a little different way now, is that if you were light, you were all right. If you were brown, you could stick around. But if you were black, get back. Now, we did that. And as a reason, we did that to ourselves as Afro-Americans coming up. So all I'm saying is, in the cultural DNA, which I'm sharing this with you, all of these things, victimology, hairdos, academic relevance, sports dominance, affirmative action, which was there to try to level the playing field, soul food, all those things in sum total comprise the DNA of Afro-Americans, but they're not monolithic. That's my point I'm trying to make. They're not monolithic. And so there's some that will embrace academic achievement, and there's others who will scorn or put down those folks who through academic achievement speak standard English and want a higher lifestyle. It's like that struggle. Yes, ma'am.
How do you give this book for
Now, good question. What I've learned, and I didn't think about it until Dr. Lourdes Ferrer, we wrote the book Voices, we did last in a session. She said something I never thought about. Latinos, Latin Americans, never went through Jim Crow. Never went through slavery here, never. Didn't even have that experience. So the DNA that talks about if you're light, you're all right, if you're black, get back, or the DNA that talks about good hair, bad hair, the like you said, the gentleman said, the institutional racism that gets internalized, that you're lesser than, that experience over time, generations, never happened to Latinos. So they have none of that in their cultural DNA to even respond to. So you'd have music, you'd have other things up there, but you wouldn't have a lot of those things there because that's not something that they experienced. Okay.
And the impact of Sheriff Joe Arpaio.
Okay.
Racial
yes.
That has been done.
Yes.
And what impact that will have on this wheel?
That's a good question. I honestly don't have the body of knowledge to answer it intelligently, and I don't want to perpetrate in front of all these people. So I will try to find an answer, and if you want to leave me your business card, I'd love to continue that dialogue, because that's a good question, and maybe I could do something with that next time. And again, I'm raising this issue so that we can again look at the underlying issues around the academic achievement gap. Because the students are telling us from the book Voices that it's really not primarily the schools. It's cultural, it's our family's low expectation, it's issues around my community that I'm involved with. It's not like the schools aren't doing a good job or the teachers aren't good. That's what the kids said. And I was glad that was what came out, because I think that's honest. Because it's easier to scapegoat or to externalize blame. Okay, so we have victimology, which is a viewpoint whereby people who don't succeed in school and life attribute it solely to racism or prejudice and the operating principles of self-fulfilling prophecy. See, I didn't make the team, so the school is prejudiced. See, I didn't get the job, so the school is prejudiced. And that's the way, that's their lens. That's victimology. Victorology talks about positive thinking. It talks about the growth mindset. This is the growth mindset. The other one is the fixed mindset. So victorology is the mindset that Obama used when he said, yes, I can. Because that was at work, taking that risk to do something no one else had done. And it's fueled by self-determination and the belief that obstacles can be overcome despite the odds. So you're gonna take those risks. How many times you're gonna get up? As many times as you need to. Somebody back there said always. So those are, then that's the split. That's another way of looking at the cultural split. There are those who embrace victorology, those who embrace victimology. And the cultural DNA has a lot to do with it. The gentleman and the invisible man who got his college education and tried to move his family was operating from victorology. But the people who didn't want to be bothered with him, who shunned him, who said, man, going back where you came from, you left us, are looking at it through victimology. Because they're still looking for that 40 acres and a mule, which is never going to come. But that's just, again, another way of looking at the mindset that drives the outcomes. Now, this is a killer the bee. I'm going to show you another film clip. This is one family. How many people have seen this movie? Okay, good. This is one clip, but what I want you to pay attention to is these two brothers in the same family. But I want you to tell me which mindset are they operating from. The growth mindset, the fixed mindset. The victimology mindset, the victorology mindset. Because based on what's happening here, this young lady has a chance to go to the National Spelling Bee. She's an Afro-American student. And so I want you to take a look at that.
He takes a maiden booty on that stage today. But you knocked out the mother words right back at that too. They were just trick words. Everybody knows pterodactyl starts with a B. Girl, if I could spell like you, I know I could be a flight attendant.
Keep it back. We go.
Hey. Tell me when you're leaving?
Yeah, bring me back to the base. Hey, the principal called Mama. Said you didn't bring up the spelling bee last week.
Messed up the word.
Yeah, but he said you got a lot of money. He also said you got an opportunity to go to an even bigger contest next week.
I don't want to do it.
Why?
Everybody's gonna be looking at him, and there's gonna be tons of words I don't know.
So you're scared, huh? Come on, how do you think I felt the first time I had to jump out of an airplane? I mean, my whole body said don't do it. And sometimes your brain gotta be smaller than your body, you know?
But I don't like myself. There was some law that I did anything for.
And do it for Daddy. We know how he was about words. He'd have loved to see you do something like this.
What mom would say about it?
Me and Halali, she got a million things to worry about. Tell you what, just in this contest, when you make it all the way to DC, I will perish in vain to see you. Would you like that?
So, which brother is operating from which mindset in this slide here? Yes, I agree. The big brother, definitely the growth mindset. He believes in her, he encourages her. Yes, she might be the only black going to the Nationals, but do it for dad, I'll jump out the airplane. But what's Mr. Hipster, what's his attitude? Mr. Young Boy with the hair all backwards telling mom to chill. What's his attitude? Oh yeah, fixed mindset. You ain't got no business, say stereotype confirmation. You ain't got no business going up against them people. They're gonna tear you up. And so if that was the only brother she had, chances are she might not even go. And this is in the same family. So you can have these two kids in your classroom, twins, both with a different mindset. They're not monolithic because there's a split in terms of the way they're thinking, maybe even in terms of the cultural split, where one believes and embraces and knows they can improve the circumstance. The other has already made up his mind that it's folly. It's total folly. So, in closing, this book here, this is a book by Dr. Walther, says Losing the Race. And he says, racism may play a marginal background in the role of black students' academic experiences, but not nearly enough to cause the massive disparities across class between black and white performance. And I agree with him. This is 2016. And there's something that has to happen within our own ranks so that kids realize the importance of education, realize early on as Bill Cosby and Dr. Poussaint in his book, Come On People. I know Bill Cosby's not that popular these days, but he made a good point. And he implored Afro-Americans to speak standard English to your babies when they're 3 and 4 years old. So when they go to kindergarten, they can at least compete. It's not cute to speak all that Ebonics, and then they go to kindergarten and say, well, we're fitting to go. Because fitting to go is not going to get it in an English class. Fitting to go may be okay, you know, at home or at a family reunion, but fitting to go is not even a word. It's not even a compound word. I'm fitting to go. I get there when I get there. Get, G-I-T. I don't think that's a word either. I mean, slang. It means go, go. So again, I think there's work to be done in terms of closing the academic achievement gap. I think schools certainly need to become more culturally competent, teachers, social workers, administrators. But I also think the Afro-American and Latinos need to also embrace the middle class norms and values that they're going to need to embrace to have jobs and careers and to move up the ladder of success in America. And so more is caught than is taught. The way we talk to our children becomes their inner voice. The way we talk to our children becomes their inner voice. When you say I'm not raising doctors and lawyers, and you say I'm not raising doctors and lawyers, and you say I'm not raising doctors and lawyers, at some point you internalize that you ain't gonna be one. But if you Mrs. Carson, who was poor and whose kid was, like I said, a candidate for juvenile detention, no question in my mind about it, and you say, yes, I can, yes, he can, yes, we will, that inner voice sooner or later will self-actualize. Two families, one operating from the growth mindset, one operating from the fixed mindset, one closing the academic achievement gap, one don't even care if the gap stays or goes. It's simply not relevant. So when you know better, you do better, Maya Angelou. So to the extent that we can know better how to forge those authentic relationships because we take time, and some of the things I explained to you today about the cultural thing, agree or disagree, and that's fine. But at least explore so that when we have kids and families that are different than us, either economic diversity or ethnic diversity, we can begin to understand how they see the world and how their mindset operate, and we can intervene, hopefully, to help them begin to take risks that the growth mindset will foster. So two things, I know our time is up. One, I'd appreciate if you'd fill out the evaluation, slide it down to the end of the table. And two, do you have any questions? Any different questions I can answer? Well, give yourselves a hand. I think you did a great job. And these are, if you get a chance, these are some quotes that the kids, then when we did the book Voices, these are some quotes directly from them. You get a chance, you might want to take a look. And there's a couple of newspaper articles that I have up here to share with you, Jet Magazine, where I published. And again, have a great day.
My name is Sarah. I just got out of the conference session on embracing a mindset for academic achievement. It was very informative, talking all about the two different types of mindsets that we can have. One being fixed, where people are just kind of set in whatever preconceived stereotypes they've been given, and one which is a growth mindset, which is more flexible, more proactive, more self-determining. And it was really inspiring and I think empowering to remember as educators that we can help our students change their mindset to realize their potential, because so many students are put in a box either by their families or by cultural stereotypes or by whatever kind of circumstances they're facing. So I think that this was a great fresh perspective about really how it goes back to the individual, and whatever they are going to decide and determine that they want to do with their life is what they will shoot for, and that's going to have tremendous implications for where they wind up in their life. So I was very thankful to be in this session and very appreciative of Mr. Garlington.